Azure Arc. What is it? Why are we going to use it? And most importantly, how do we get this thing going? Well, as always, when we talk about what is Azure, I'm going to tell you all about it coming up now. Hello, everybody. My name is Adam Gordon, an edutainer here at ITProTV, back with another exciting episode in our What is Azure serial. In this conversation, we're going to be tackling what is Azure Arc, a brand new offering from Microsoft that is really exciting. And we're going to tackle it with our three traditional questions and help you to understand what it is. We've got some cool stuff we'll talk about to explain that, why you may want to use it, and most importantly, how we actually make this thing work for us. And we'll take a look at how to implement Azure Arc after we're done talking about the cool little diagram I have here on the light board. Let's jump in and begin by talking about what Azure Arc is. When we think about Azure Arc, what we see on the diagram is the ability to use different distinct areas where we often will have infrastructure or services at our beck and call in our organizations. Traditionally, we will have on-premises infrastructure, what we call our rack and stack environment, where in our data centers, we have servers, we have desktops, we have all sorts of stuff that is living in our buildings, in our facilities, and of course, stacked up for us to use. It's probably been there for a long time, and it's still a very important part of what we do to provide services every day. But we also have one or more cloud environments, like Microsoft Azure, that are becoming much, much more important to our ability to not only provide infrastructure and the services to use that infrastructure, but to do so at scale globally or across our operational landscape, wherever that may be, and to do so to tens, hundreds, perhaps thousands of individual customers and users. But these days, to do so, spreading our risk and our capability throughout multiple cloud vendors, hence the idea of multi-cloud, because we may not want to put all of our cloud eggs into one cloud basket. And so we see things like AWS, Google Cloud Platform, Oracle and Dell/VMware's business cloud platforms available to us more and more being used by organizations side by side with Microsoft Azure and with our on-premises environments. In addition, we see newer technology capabilities being brought in from what we call edge computing and edge platforms. You would think of these in your personal life as an IoT, an Internet of Things device, whether you have Alexa, whether you have Cortana, whether you have one or more home automation platforms that you're using, whether you are using remote management capabilities for far-flung infrastructure to monitor, to maintain, to operate, whether you may have some sort of assembly line automation capability in your business, or any kind of devices that are IP-enabled and are designed specifically to work in these environments, we're seeing more and more that these capabilities are also becoming part of what we have to manage. And so when we see all of this individually, kind of isolated from each other, this is our prototypical traditional world. What Azure Arc brings to us is the ability to be able to link these together and allow them to interact with each other, giving us the capability to see, to manage at scale, to automate and to optimize the capabilities that these individual platforms provide, but to do so by bringing them all together so we can see them and interact with them in one common management or monitoring capability. So that's really the what, being able to bring these infrastructure elements under management. Leads us to the why, and I've kind of hinted at the answer to the why already, a single management interface that we can leverage wherever we are sitting to be able to make that available to our management and monitoring teams. We're thinking our ability for either global management in our network operations center, maybe regionally in one of our localized management areas, or even from our on-premises environment or from the edge or from multi-cloud or from all of them, our ability to reach out and see one, but interact with all. And so the why is really about creating and using what we call commonly a single pane of glass management capability. The idea of interacting with, managing, and seeing all this infrastructure in one place becomes really, really important. And as we draw our arrows to bring that capability in, We see that on any of these monitoring screens, in theory, should be able to interact with and see all of this. Now, this is important, but what we're really addressing here as we talk about this is the ability at scale to really think about managing and minimizing at the same time. Managing infrastructure, globally scaling it, optimizing and making it work for us, even across multiple vendor stacks, but at the same time, minimizing. What do we want to minimize? Minimize risk and threat. Because when we think about multi-cloud environments, on-premises capabilities, edge computing capabilities, there are unique and specific threats, risks, and vulnerabilities associated with each of these areas. Wouldn't it be great if we can collapse them all together, monitor and maintain them in one area, and ultimately not only expose them and manage them, but secure them and understand how they're functioning without having to go to each individual area to do so? This is the beauty of the why. Management at scale across all our infrastructure elements, one pane of glass, one visible element to manage and ultimately help us to understand them all. When we think about how, our last question, as you know, if you've watched any of our episodes in the series, we always transition over to our demo environment where I show you how to spin up and ultimately set up and perhaps even configure certain elements of this particular or any particular service. We're going to do that for Azure Arc as well, but I just want to remind you of something when we're talking about Azure Arc. It's a brand new offering, and as we look at how, it may look a little different over time, and so be on the lookout for not only how to do this, but updates and changes as you go to deploy Azure Arc. I'll see you when we talk about how to do this in just a moment, and while I'm getting ready to do this demonstration, think about all the cool things we can do and all the cool administration, capabilities, architecture, and infrastructure you're going to bring to bear when you start using Azure Arc. All right, everybody, time to actually roll up our sleeves, get out those fingers, and we're going to see how we actually bring Azure Arc online and get it ready. We're going to go ahead and search for Azure Arc as a service in the Azure portal. I've already logged on, just making that step a little bit easier for us to skip over. All services is where we're going to begin. We're going to type in under the All Services search bar, beginning to type the word Azure. We'll see Azure Arc pops up on the list. It's not necessarily alphabetized, but it should show up near the top. So just look for it. You'll see I've highlighted it over to the right. I'm going to go ahead and click on it. And when I do that, we'll be able to see the Azure Arc landing page. We're on the overview pane or tab. We see the get started area. We've got some resources that could be brought under management here, a smattering and an interaction with both on-premises in our rack and stack environment in the data center, things like servers that could be on-premise as well as hosted in the cloud fabric, Kubernetes clusters, databases, a variety of different resources that are available to us. And as we go down below there, we do see cost and pricing, and we'll take a look at that in just a minute. Now, on the Getting Started tab, what we see is the ability to be able to, just bring that over there so we can see it, add in existing infrastructure with a little link that takes us there immediately, things like servers and Kubernetes clusters. Notice it says we can add them to Azure for free, pay only for additional Azure services you use, and there's an invitation, a little link there to learn more. You could add that existing infrastructure, and Microsoft Azure and Azure Arc will manage it for you without additional cost when you add additional services on top that you would normally use. The Azure Sentinel solution as part of the Azure Security Center, perhaps other services or capabilities. We pay for that. It's a pay-as-you-go model. We simply extend that use to this part of the platform, and then we pay for those services. So we get some for free and some we have to pay for. We could go ahead and you'll see we can deploy Azure data services anywhere, deploy and use those data services in and on the Kubernetes clusters we run, and again, manage those through the Azure Arc capability. Remember, single pane of glass, one environment that shows us everything that gives us those capabilities, and then view all of our Azure Arc resources. Down here just means we could essentially have a shortcut right to that link that says all Azure Arc resources, right? So we're really adding in and deploying those capabilities, and we can see those resources are individually listed. Now notice a lot of them have the word preview in parentheses at the end of their name. That means currently Microsoft is essentially test driving these features, bringing them online as part of the Azure Arc offering. And over time, that preview tag will disappear. They'll look like the word servers, and they'll be fully available. They may change a little bit as that process takes place. And over time, Microsoft has made clear in their roadmap that there'll be additional offerings made available through Azure Arc, but it's early in the deployment, and therefore, we're just really now beginning to see what that story is going to unfold like. When we look at pricing, just to give you a sense of what I talked about here, it does show us, and I like the fact that Microsoft is very upfront about what you get for free and then what you pay for down below with additional services like Azure Security Center, Azure Monitoring, Azure Policy, et cetera. Again, subject to change as Microsoft modifies these systems over time. Currently, Kubernetes is free. As you bring on Kubernetes resources, you may pay for that at some point in the future. So just keep that in mind. With regards to actually going in and deploying any one of these resource areas, server, let's say, hypothetically, if we want to add that infrastructure, we select one of those areas, use the add button, walk through one of our, or more than one of our wizard tabs to facilitate whatever we want to bring online, providing the appropriate information as we go through. You could see each one of these lets us see, interact with, or have access to already existent infrastructure as needed. I haven't deployed any servers yet, so I don't see any of my Kubernetes capabilities. My SQL Server database or databases can be deployed here. And if I have any data controllers that I want to deploy, I can add those. And or I could see any of my Azure Stack capabilities, again, that would be exposed from other areas of the Azure portal. By bringing all this together in one place and making it available, I've got this single instance, a single pane of glass that I can use to manage. Now, some of you may say, well, Adam, this is good, but didn't we already have this capability in Azure just by using the portal? Well, we did, but we had to go to a lot of different places to see it, and only would we be able to see the Azure-centric infrastructure, not the on-premises infrastructure, and not the multi-cloud infrastructure. Now, we're extending that capability beyond the boundary of Azure to include all those additional elements, and as a result, we're really scaling up and scaling out our single pane of glass, truly seeing all those things that make up our operational capabilities in our infrastructure across the entire operational landscape of our business globally, if necessary. I'll be back with additional features, capabilities, and always updating our What is Azure thought process to include new services, new features, and new elements that you want to be aware of. But until I come back with another exciting look at Azure services, I'm going to wish you happy Azuring, and I'll see you soon.